The problem of scruples is the problem at hand in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 8, as we now come to the sixth problem that Paul deals with out of 16 that he will cover in the letter. The chapter, 1 Corinthians 8, is only 13 verses long. It might be the shortest chapter in the letter itself, but even though it is very briefly written, the material in it has great application to present circumstances. In fact, throughout history, men have been having opinions that they have felt inclined to bind on their brethren. And this chapter speaks to that very attitude. And Paul addresses, number one, that every scruple has an answer. There is a final, definitive right or wrong. Number two, he discusses how I may have the knowledge that it's right, but still hold it to myself that I think it's wrong. But then number three, I may not bind what I think is wrong on someone else when God has decided that it is not, in fact, wrong. So it is a very brief discussion, but it is rich in application. And because many of us have no doubt experienced times when perhaps ourselves or others have tried to bind their opinions when it is the Word of God that should be held as the highest standard. He also discusses this topic in Romans chapter 14, which at the appropriate time we'll go back to and notice exactly what he has to say about that then. But here in 1 Corinthians 8, it's the sixth problem that he deals with when he discusses the problem of scruples. So let's start by reading the chapter. As I said, it's not very long. We'll begin 1 Corinthians 8, starting in verse 1. Paul writes, "Now touching things offered unto idols, we know that we all have knowledge. Knowledge puffs up, but charity edifies. And if any man think that he knows anything, he knows nothing, yet as he ought to know. But if any man love God, the same is known of him. As concerning therefore the eating of those things that are offered in sacrifice unto idols, we know that an idol is nothing in the world, and that there is none other God but one. For though there be that are called gods, whether in heaven or in earth, as there be gods many and lords many, but to us there is but one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we in him, and one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him. Howbeit there is not in every man that knowledge, for some with conscience of the idol, unto this hour eat it as a thing offered unto an idol, and their conscience being weak is defiled. But meat commends us not to God, for neither if we eat are we better, or neither if we eat not are we worse. But take heed lest by any means this liberty of yours become a stumbling block to them that are weak. For if any man see thee which has knowledge sit in the meat of the idol's temple, shall not the conscience of him that is weak be emboldened to eat those things which are offered to idols? And through thy knowledge shall the weak brother perish for whom Christ died. But when you sin so against the brethren and wound their weak conscience, you sin against Christ. Wherefore, if meat makes my brother to offend, I will eat no flesh while the world stands, lest I make my brother to offend." And so we have here before us the topic of scruples. Now, as you notice, the word scruple never appears in this text because it's not a religious word necessarily. It's just a word. It means a personally held conviction, a personally held belief that I hold to myself and limit myself in what I may or may not do that I hold in my own conscience. The most common example, and it's not necessarily alluded to here, but you can easily see how you could get to that point. The most common example would be a vegetarian. Someone who has a scruple about being a vegetarian is one who would say, "I can't eat meat. I think it is wrong to eat meat." And so they hold to themselves this binding. They bind on themselves the inability to eat meat. That's a scruple. And so we're dealing with that here. Although in this context, it is not just eating meat, it's eating meat that had been previously offered in a pagan worship to a false little g god. And now you have these Christians, presumably in Corinth, these Corinthian Christians, I mean, who go to the meat markets, buy this meat, knowing that it had been offered in the back of that meat market in the temple area to the idol. It was killed, it was sacrificed, it was prayed to whatever little g god they have, and then they would turn around and take the meat that had been cooked on the altar and sell it like at a market. And so these Christians would think to themselves, if I eat this meat, I am condoning idolatry. Therefore, I become an idolizer. It could even be the case that many of these ones who have this scruple were former idolaters. And thus, eating the meat was reminding them of their past life of sin. And so they thought, I can't do so. Nothing wrong with saying you can't do that. The problem comes when you try to bind that on others. Now, Paul is not so much discussing the binding of it here. He does that in Romans 14, which we'll get to later. Here he's taking it from the perspective of the one who doesn't have the scruple, needing to be careful that he doesn't cause his brother with the scruple to be tempted or to be to stumble into the sin of eating it and defiling his own conscience. One thing that comes clear out of this is that if I defile my own conscience, even though God may say it's not wrong, if I think it's wrong and I do it, then it becomes wrong for me and therefore is wrong. So one of the things that we're going to notice as we notice this text is how for every scruple that may be had, there is an answer to it. Is it actually wrong in the sight of God to eat meat offered to an idol, or is it okay? He answers that in this text. Another thing he does is he answers this idea of, well, you can think it's wrong, but I think it's right, so I'll do it and you just have to get over it. It's true that I may do it if I want, and if I don't want, I have every right not to do so. But it's very important that I'm conscious of my relationship with you and what I'm doing out in the open in front of you that might cause you to defile your own conscience. I have to be careful of my own brother and he of me. So there's several different moving pieces in this text that we will notice as we go through it. One thing that we want to point out is this is not talking about the law of God, that is the things that God has commanded us to do or not do. This is concerning things separate from that. God has made it very clear what things we are allowed to do and not do. With a scruple, what you have is, if there's the baseline of the line of fellowship with God, if I cross it, if I transgress over that line, that is the definition of sin. Sin is the transgression of the law. So if I have this baseline here, and I know I can't go over this line, then if I go over it, then I'm sinning. A scruple is when I draw the line a little bit lower than that. And even though God says you can go a little bit higher than that line down here, my scruple doesn't allow me to. In this text, what he says is, essentially, it's okay to eat meat that had been offered to an idol, generally speaking. If you have the scruple, it's not, but that's not what he means. Generally speaking, if it is okay to eat meat offered to an idol. In other words, it's not wrong. Here's God's baseline. It's not wrong. These brethren, though, who have the scruple, have drawn their own line a little bit lower than God's, and they've said, I can't do it. I won't do it. And then trying to bind it is where the problem comes. That's not to say God has made the line here and I can draw the line a little bit higher. God has said you can't do this, but then I'll say, well, you can do it a little bit, and so I'll draw the line a little bit higher and say you can go a little bit beyond that line. No, that's transgressing. That's stepping over the line, and that's sinning. What a scruple is stepping on the other side of the line, stepping before the line, not stepping beyond it. So now we have the problem laid out. Let's notice the verses verse by verse. First of all, the first verse, now as concerning things offered unto idols, we know that we all have knowledge, that is, an opinion. We all have an opinion about this. He's not discussing the law of God. He's discussing different people, different having different opinions. Some say it's okay, some say it's wrong. We all have an opinion. Opinions sometimes puff us up, make us arrogant. My opinion is better than your opinion, is probably the default setting that all of us have within ourselves. Knowledge puffs up. Having our own opinion makes us arrogant, but we can temper that with charity, with love. Love builds us up. Love edifies. You see the contrast. My opinion puffs me up artificially, but love edifies us, builds us up, and that's not artificial. Verse 2, if any man think that he knows anything, he knows nothing, yet as he ought to know. If this guy wants to be a know-it-all, then he knows not at all. So a person wants to make their opinion more important than your opinion, automatically nullifies his opinion in the eyes of God. So if you want to be a know-it-all, then you know nothing at all. That's how you should be looking at it. You should be going into it as though you say, it doesn't matter what my opinion is. It matters how it affects my brother, which he'll get to at the end of this verse or chapter. Verse 3, but if any man love God, the same is known of God. That's the contrast to verse 2. So let's read those together. If any man thinks that he knows anything, he knows nothing yet as he ought to know. But if a man love God, the same as known of God. If I can trust God more than my opinion, I'm doing right. If I put aside what I know, my opinion, then I can be known of God. It's a word play that Paul does, as he does frequently in his letters. Now, here's the context. Verse 4. As concerning, therefore, the eating of those things that are offered in sacrifice unto idols. So you have eating meat that have been sacrificed to a false god. We know, notice, he answers the scruple right here. We know that an idol is nothing in the world, and that there is none other God but the one God. So that answers the scruple. Is it wrong to eat meat offered to an idol? The answer is no, in general. No, because there's no such thing as an idol. An idol is just what that other guy is making a god out of, but it's not a god. It's just a statue. It's just his figment of his imagination. So you're just eating meat. He offered it to an idol. He's the one committing sacrilege. He's the one committing paganism and blasphemy and everything else. But you're just eating a steak. Because an idol doesn't exist except in the mind of the person who's created it. An idol is nothing in the world. And so though there's a lot of little g gods out there, we know there's only one god. Verse 5. For though there are be that are called gods, whether in the sky or on the ground, in heaven or earth, it says, as there be gods many and lords many. We know that there are idols all over the place. We know that pagans have their gods everywhere, especially in Corinth, which was a city rich in paganism and idolatry. Verse 6, but to us, to Christians, there is but one God, the Father. And then he very poetically describes the greatness of God versus the idols. One God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we in him. There's one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him, which you can't say of an idol, since you have 1,000 idols, and so they all have a different hand in the different things in the world. God's greater than them, because all things are made by him. So now verse 7. Howbeit there is not in every man that knowledge. Not everybody understands that. Not everybody holds to that within themselves. And so what happens is a person says, but I think it's like idolatry. But I see it as idolatry. And since idolatry is wrong, they have made this idolatry. Even though God says, but it's not idolatry. But if you make it idolatry to yourself and you do so, then you become an idol worshiper. Verse 7, howbeit there is not in every man that knowledge. For some, with conscience of the idol, unto this hour eat it as a thing offered unto an idol, and their conscience being weak is defiled. Unto this hour, he means presently. These Christians who were once idol worshippers are right now thinking of themselves as idol worshippers by simply eating this meat that had previously been offered to an idol. And thus they defile their conscience, knowing that idolatry is wrong, and thus they sin. And so here's the dilemma. Do we just not eat meat? Does some not eat meat? Can some eat it and some not and do it privately or publicly? How do we resolve this? And that's what the chapter does. It resolves the dispute. Verse 8. But meat commends us not to God, for neither if we eat are we better, nor if we eat not are we worse. Once again, there is an answer to the scruple. In general, it's not wrong to eat meat because meat doesn't do anything, eating it or not eating it, in terms of my relationship with God. Again, generally speaking. For those who have a weak conscience, it becomes a problem. But just generally speaking, eating meat or not eating meat is irrelevant. If you want to be a vegetarian or a vegan, by all means, be a vegetarian or a vegan. Eating meat or not eating meat doesn't matter. Verse 9. But take heed, lest by any means this liberty of yours, this freedom that you have to eat that meat, becomes a stumbling block to them that are weak. Now, how might my ability to eat meat be a stumbling block? The word means literally something that is placed as a thing that might cause them to spiritually trip, stumble. It means literally what it sounds like, a block you stumble over. But metaphorically, what it means is something I might do that might cause my brother to sin. So how might my freedom and my understanding it's okay to eat meat cause my brother with a scruple to sin? I'm not making him eat meat. Verse 10, he explains, for if any man who has the scruple see you which has knowledge, you who can eat the meat, sit at meat in the idol's temple. Now, mind you, he's not saying you're going into some false church building, because you had the temple and in the end of it was like a little meat market where they would sell that meat. So that's what he's saying, like the meat market. If any man see thee which has knowledge, sitting in meat, that is eating the food, at the idol's temple, shall not the conscience of him which is weak be emboldened to eat those things which are offered to idols? He sees you doing it, and now his conscience starts to bother him. Well, if he can do it, could I do it? I mean, I think it's wrong, but if I see him doing it, maybe I can do it. And so he does it. His conscience gets messed up because he does it. After he does it, he feels guilty, and thus he realizes he's now sinned. Not directly, specifically against God, but he's sinned against his own conscience, which is therefore a sin against God. And so my doing it publicly has caused this brother to sin. Verse 11. And through thy knowledge, the weak brother perishes, for whom Christ died. Look, Jesus died to take away this person's sins, but by my eating meat, I have inadvertently caused him to sin. and I've caused them to perish, the word means to sin. Verse 12. But when you sin so against the brethren and wound their weak conscience, you sin against Christ. That means me. Me who has the ability to eat meat and it not be a problem. Now I've sinned against Christ because I've done so without respect to my brother's scruple. He's not saying if you don't know he has the scruple and you do it and he stumbles and sins that you're liable, that you're guilty. What the implication is, I know my brother has the scruple, but I don't care about my brother. That's the overall problem with the church at Corinth. It's appeared numerous times in various problems. Is the lack of care for their brethren. But I know he has the scruple, and I don't care, so I will just eat it anyway, and in doing so, I cause him to stumble, and thus I cause myself to stumble. That's the problem. And so Paul says what the attitude should be, knowing my brother has a scruple, it should be to say, if meat makes my brother offend, I'll eat no meat as long as the world stands, so that I don't make my brother to offend. People have taken this to the extreme, and they've taken themselves into the position of the one with the scruple. And they've gone around trying to police people and saying, you can't do that, and you can't do that, and you can't do that because I have a scruple. Well, if you have a scruple, we're going to get to Romans 14. Paul says you're supposed to keep it to yourself. Your scruple is supposed to be between you and God. If you start going around telling brethren what they can and can't do, now you're making a law where God did not. Because as we see clearly here, there's no law against eating meat offered to an idol. Otherwise, Paul would have condemned the brethren who went to the idol's temple, who bought the meat, and who ate it. He doesn't condemn that, though. What he condemns is them doing it publicly. He condemns them doing it flippantly in front of their brethren, causing them to stumble. But just eating meat offered to an idol, he doesn't condemn at all. He says it doesn't matter one way or the other, verse 8 of the chapter. But when I start telling my brethren, you can't do that because it's against my scruple, then I am taking my opinions and making them God's law, telling my brethren what they can and can't do, and that's a no-no. Now, if you go back a few pages to the book of Romans, chapter 14, here again this problem comes up. Romans 14, beginning in verse 1, Paul says, him that is weak in the faith receive you, and not to doubtful disputations. In other words, him that is weak in the faith is a person who has a scruple. He'll get to in just a second. And I should accept that brother. I should not be looking to make arguments with him. I should not be trying to talk him out of his scruples, these doubtful disputations. He gives an example now, verse 2. For one believes that he may eat all things, another who is weak eats herbs. So he very clearly lays out who is the strong and who is the weak. The strong doesn't mean someone who has a great knowledge of the Bible. The strong doesn't mean someone who's been a Christian for 50 years, necessarily. This person who is strong in the faith could be a Christian for a year, and the weak brother could be an elder of 80 years old. It doesn't matter. Strong, weak only means, does he have a scruple, or does he not have the scruple in this one particular thing? So, and he uses an illustration to explain it in the one that we used earlier, vegetarian. One can eat everything, another one says, I can only eat herbs, or not animals. Verse 3. Let him that eats despise him that eats not. Let not him that eats despise him that eats not. If I can eat meat, I should not be looking down on the one who doesn't eat meat. But then he turns the tables. Let not him that eats not judge him that eats. If I can't eat meat, if I have a scruple not to eat meat, then I can't look down on the one who does eat meat. Because God has received him. That's how he ends that verse. The pronoun isn't specific. Who is God receiving? That's just it. He's receiving both of them. The one who eats and the one who doesn't. Who are you, verse 4, to judge another man's servant? To his own master he stands or falls. Yea, he shall be holding up, for God is able to make him stand. Who are you to judge the servant of God? It doesn't matter whether he eats meat or not. Verse 5, here's another example. One man esteems one day above another, another esteems every day alike. We have holidays in our culture, in our country, just as they had back then. Back then, you were dealing with Jewish holy days that these Christians now continued to observe just by tradition and not by law. And some were looking down on them for binding these, or holding to these days, saying, you know, you're not bound by the law of Moses anymore. You shouldn't be having these Jewish holy days marked on your calendar, and you shouldn't be celebrating them. But Paul says they have every right to celebrate them if they want. They're just days. You celebrate a holy day every year. If it's your birthday, that's a holiday. A holy day, a holy day. And so we have all these holidays on our calendar. We have Valentine's Day, we have Easter, we have Thanksgiving and Christmas and everything in between. There's one every month, if not more. And some say, well, you shouldn't have holy days, holidays, because Sunday is the only holiday that you should observe. Well, I observe the first day of the week as the day given for me to worship God. But I recognize that there are days that I can make on my own and have a special thing for. You know, I have a day every year where I eat a lot of turkey and watch football. I have another day that I set aside to give gifts to my family. I have another day where I hide eggs and make my children go find them. We have holidays. It just simply means a day we set aside for something. It doesn't have to be for something sacred. It just means separate, which is what the word holy means in general. So, verse 5, he says, one esteems one day above another one treats them all equally. Verse 6, he that regards the day regards it to the Lord, and he that regards not the day to the Lord he doesn't regard it. In other words, they're both doing right by God. I take this day that I have set aside to be the day of thanksgiving, but I still give God credit for the day. I still praise God in that day. The other person who says, but I won't treat that day any more special than the others, I'm going to treat them all as special days and give God glory for it, is also giving God the glory. So they're doing no difference. He that eats, eats to the Lord, for he gives God thanks. When I eat my steak, I thank God for it. He that eats not also gives God thanks. He that eats his salad also gives God thanks for it. Now, go down to the end of the chapter of Romans 14. Verse 20. For meat destroys not the work of God. All things indeed are pure, but it is evil for the man who eats with offense. There's nothing wrong with eating meat, but if I eat it with offense, that is to say, if I eat it thinking it's wrong, then I've done wrong. It is good neither to eat meat or drink wine, nor anything whereby thy brother stumbles, or is offended, or is made weak. In other words, I should be careful what I eat and drink that someone else might have a problem with if it's a scruple. We're not talking about the things that God has outlawed. We're talking about the things that man has bound on himself not to do. We need to be cautious of our brethren to make sure that we don't offend their own consciences. But that doesn't mean my brother with a scruple can come running to me telling me what all of his scruples are and making me hold to his scruples. Because verse 22 says, have you got faith? And he doesn't mean your faith in Christ. He doesn't mean the faith, the system of faith. He means, have you got a scruple? That's the context. Have you got an opinion that you're holding to yourself? Keep it to yourself. I don't need to know what your scruples are. You don't need to know what my scruples are. If I don't know what your scruples are, then I won't worry about my conscience when I'm eating meat. And if you keep your scruples to yourself, then when you see me eating meat, you can just leave the room so that our scruples aren't crossing paths and so that our consciences aren't being defiled against each other. Have you got a scruple? Keep it to yourself. Happy is he that condemns not himself in the thing which he allows. Better just not to know that you're doing something someone else has a problem with. And he that doubts is condemned if he eats, because he eats not of faith. For whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Again, faith in the context, scruples. If you eat something that is against your conscience, if you do something that's against your conscience, that's sin. Never mind the fact if you do something that's against God's law, that's sin. That's understood. Separate from God's law, if you have bound something else to yourself and you make that a scruple and you go against it, that's sin. That doesn't mean that you can't talk yourself out of a scruple. The brethren reading 1 Corinthians 8 might read this and think, huh, you know, an idol really doesn't exist. I guess I can just get over it. And if they do get over it, then they can freely eat the meat. But if they still say, but I just can't get over it, I recognize it's not right, it's okay, but I just can't get over it, then they should not eat the meat. And so that's the problem with scruples. It comes up so many times. And really the issue is brethren just binding their scruples. And if we would just keep our opinions to ourselves, then the brethren would know what our scruples are. And then we wouldn't have these kinds of conflicts. The problem with 1 Corinthians 8 is the brethren are, number one, telling each other their opinions, and number two, not caring about each other's opinions. And so Paul regulates both. He says in Romans, keep your opinions to yourself. But he says in 1 Corinthians 8, if you know it, now you have to be careful for your brother. In other words, love your brother. Care for your brother. Him that is weak in the faith, receive. As he says in Romans chapter 14. The ongoing problem in 1 Corinthians, though, is this problem just not having any regard for the brethren. You see it from chapters 1 through 4 when we dealt with division. They were divided because they couldn't get along. You see it in chapter 5 when they wouldn't withdraw fellowship from a sinning brother because they didn't have care for him. You saw it in chapter 6 when they were suing each other because they wouldn't work out their problems. Now again in chapter 8, they're binding scruples on each other, or they're being flippant and casual with the consciences of their brethren, again because they don't care about their fellow man. The lack of love is potent in the church at Corinth. But we're not at chapter 13 yet, the love chapter. We're going to start chapter 9 and problem number 7 this time next week, which concerns paying the preacher. Again, a problem of love. We'll get to that chapter when we get to it. Until then, thank you for listening.